That's right. Thank you very much. Okay. Well, landscapes all have our interest, and there is a need for more integrated action towards landscapes. IDH is an organization that's worked in private sector supply chains, and we recognize that the private sector is a key driver of land use change. So also in these landscapes approaches, they need to be part of the conversation. Now, is there a business case for businesses to get involved in protecting forest areas, in restoring? Yes, there is. And the business case is related to either long-term productivity of producing companies, and it's often related to reputational risk for producing for companies that are sourcing from these landscapes. IDH in the past has worked mainly in the supply chains, and although interventions have been meaningful, especially focusing on social aspects, the natural resource side of these single supply chain interventions has been very limited, because there are always multiple stakeholders that are addressing that are needed to address these cross-cutting issues like deforestation. Our new initiative is an initiative on sustainable landscapes. It's starting in 6 landscapes now, and there are 5 more coming. And I'd like to illustrate a bit the work that is being done by an example from Kenya. Now, Kenya, it's going to come up shortly. Kenya is a country that is producing a lot of tea, and the engagement of IDH has also been around the tea sector. In the Kenya landscape program, we're working in the southwest Mau forest, and the Mau forest complex is an important water tower in Kenya, so it's a region that is maintaining a lot of water resources for the country. And it's also a region that has been heavily deforested in the past 10 years. Partially because of political handouts of land, but also because of population growth. Now, the tea sector is also important for the livelihoods of people in that region, and our initial work there, together with the tea companies and other stakeholders, of course, has been around providing livelihoods, intensifying tea yields, providing farmer field schools, not only focusing on tea, but also focus on diversification of livelihoods. So here you see examples of that, like poultry farming, rabbit farming, dairy farming intensification, to sustain the livelihoods of the growing population in the landscape. But there is an issue with the tea around Kericho, and that is related to changes in the microclimate. Because of deforestation, tea yields have reduced significantly, and the tea estates and also the smallholders are suffering from that. Changes in the microclimate and changes in the water availability in the region. Sometimes there are droughts, sometimes there are floods. So there's increasing momentum for the stakeholders to come together. And that is what we've started to convene since 2014, working with the businesses, the communities, and the different governments of the different districts in the region to sit together and together make a plan. How are we going to save the forest? Because we all recognize we need it. Now, of course, while planning and doing research into drivers of deforestation and what interventions may be needed, it was also important to keep the process practical. So the initiatives that were just easily started, we called them no regret options, are related to tree planting, working with tree nurseries with the communities. And meanwhile, the strategy was formed with a group of stakeholders on what needed to be done. And that was related to maintaining and protecting the forest, improving governance of the forest, but also creating more sustainable livelihoods, sustainable energy options, because also the tea sector consumes a lot of energy for tea drying, and water conservation. Now, first for and I'm going to tell you a bit about the interventions that we're looking into now with the stakeholders that we can co-fund and for which we're mobilizing additional investors to make that work over the longer term. These relate first to putting in a physical barrier or creating more buffer zones for communities where they can have the benefits of the forest without having to go into the forest. But also better governance is needed, not only depending on the Kenya Forest Service, but also on multiple stakeholders collaborating in monitoring the forest, because there is still a lot of charcoal production and a lot of people entering the forest illegally, which is causing forest degradation. Besides that, new energy solutions are being needed. So alternatives are being sought after and are now being promoted by the coalition related to household energy, but also more efficient use of energy in the tea sector. A third important element is going to be related to combining, intensification of dairy farming, because there's a lot of cattle entering the forest to graze, which is leading to forest degradation. And with support, communities are now entering dairy farming systems where they have more production and more yields per head of cattle. Water availability is also important. The communities need water that is coming from the forest, but it's drying up. So protection of springs and wells is also a key intervention, and hotspots are now being protected with this type of well protection schemes. And of course, as a water tower, protection of the forest is important for the hydropower companies that are generating power from the water that is coming from this landscape. So also the hydropower companies are part of this coalition, are investing in forest restoration for their own good. So actually this work has led to the realization of all these different groups of stakeholders that they depend on the Mau Forest Complex for the long-term productivity within the region. And also them conversing together has led to this plan of action and also more focused mobilization of resources to start addressing this. So it's one of our pioneering landscapes, and it's very promising to see that this business case, although many people argue that it's not there, is actually being strongly recognized by these global companies that are producing in the region and is being acted upon by these practical examples in the field. And it's all multi-stakeholder work, so it's the companies, the communities and the government closely collaborating, and I think that is a very promising signal, and I hope that we together can mobilize many more of these types of interventions going forward. So this is the slogan of the people that are in the Mau Forest Complex. It's building our flourishing future. And I hope that that is an effort that we can all try and replicate and learn from in the future. Thank you.